So this presentation is about how can you use PhantomJS inside your Selenium tests to speed up your workflow. So a bit about me. I'm a senior engineer for Newstar. I work on the web performance monitor agent. That's the component we use in the backend for our services. I'm also a contributor to PhantomJS. And I spend a lot of time doing all sorts of crap on GitHub, tweeting rants most of the time, or when I'm not coding, cooking food, or trying to be a cyclist. And I only recently started to use Selenium, so please go easy on me because I might be missing some points. So just a few words about a new start WPM agent. This component is it's part of our backend, and it's what executes our customer scripts. And it's a service that we host on different cloud services, EC2, Rackspace, and our tests are completely written in JavaScript. We provide a bridge between JavaScript and Selenium, plus a lot of other APIs that are used by our customers. And probably the most important aspect of the whole thing is how long it takes to execute our scripts and report information about the status of the page or whatever kind of test they want to execute on their website. I'm told I should ask, I should tell you that we are hiring. So what is all this fuss about PhantomJS? How many of you have used or know about PhantomJS? Quite good. So, what is PhantomJS? It's an headless version of WebKit. Precisely, it's based on the Qt WebKit wrapper. It's completely written by driven by JavaScript, and that makes, at least from my point of view, makes it highly hackable. People are coming up with all sorts of scenarios on how to use it. Most of the time, stuff we didn't think about. It's ideal for testing because it's a very good solution if you want to add it to your pre-commit hooks. If you want to ensure that whatever goes in has been tested and you want to do it in a very little window of time, you can hook it to your repository. Stuff like Git supports pre-commit hooks, not SVN, as far as I know. And so in general, it's very cloud-friendly as a solution. At the moment, there is a very good momentum around it. There are decent contributors, and probably not me. A lot of feedbacks we are getting on the project, and most of the time, if you raise an issue that is important enough or that really causes a known bug, we try to fix it as quick as possible. But majority of the credit should go to the main maintainer, Aria. And at the moment, there are different projects that are spinning out of it. The most important at the moment are Portergeist, that is, I think it's a driver for Capybara, I think. Then there is this framework, CasperJS. It's sort of an enrichment of the API built on PhantomJS. So flexibility. I don't know if you can read it. Maybe I should. Can you read it? Yeah? This is just to show that in something like 20 lines of code, you are spinning out a server, and at the same time, you are opening a web page, a real WebKit web page, and connecting to it. It's a very stupid scenario, but actually represents the kind of flexibility that you can have from PhantomJS. Speed. We aim at making it as fast as possible and try to write fairly good Qt C++. But the most important aspect, what really makes it fast, is the fact that we are not drawing anything. The browser is going through all the steps of rendering a real web page. The only thing that is missing is the moment in which we take the layout tree and transform it into a bitmap that you can see on the screen. And that actually saves a lot of time. It's also extremely easy to get started. You just download the binary and submit the script, you're ready to go. Actually, I just implemented a REST interface, so you can even spin it out and have a command line and just throw JavaScript at it. I think that counts as speed too. I mean, how long it takes for you to get started with the project is always important. Our old web test suite runs in something like 2 seconds on my old Mac, on my old iMac, so pretty good performance. And in the future, we might gonna get V8 instead of the current JavaScript core that we use is the plain, I think it's called Spider Monkey, the one in the default WebKit. But I mean, V8 is recognized by almost everyone as faster. So Qt WebKit in the future will move to V8, so we will automatically move to V8 as well. Of course, though, PhantomJS does come with some drawbacks. Probably the most important thing is the fact that it's only one WebKit engine. This means that while WebKit is the same, I don't know if you ever experienced trying to build WebKit from source code. You can literally tune it to do whatever you want and turn on and turn off features. So ultimately, you have a Qt WebKit that is slightly different from Safari, that is slightly different from Chrome. And most importantly, you have all the different variants of WebKit on mobile. You have a very good set of consistent features, but there are also a lot of inconsistency, particularly if you try to use some advanced features. And a lot of people don't like asynchronous API, but this is JavaScript. We focused on stick with JavaScript, so adding up. At the moment, we have disabled the support for any plugin, such as Flash or Java. The reason being is that the support is not really, really good in Qt, and it also is an hassle to maintain. And we wanted to really go completely headless. In the previous version of PhantomJS, we had to, if you wanted to run it on a system without an X server running, you had to run an X virtual frame buffer and then connect Phantom to it. And that was a pain in the ass for a lot of people, so we preferred to go for the completely headless solution. And but we are working on an alternative way where we will allow people to develop plugins and add them in to PhantomJS if they really want, for example, to run websites that are written in Flash. As masochistic as that sounds. So now I want to ask a simple question. How much do you value your time as developers or testers? Well, simple equation of what is time and how it correlates with the distance and speed. So what we really need is to increase our speed to have more time on our hands. Or, I mean, a friend suggests we should just go less distance. So in a very non-mathematically correct way, how much does take to test? Well, from my point of view, it's a combination between two things. The time it takes for you to write a test, and that can be a function of how easy it is to use a platform. But most importantly, in how long it takes to run the test, because you're not going to run the thing once, you're going to run it all the time. And there are some situations where that really is a pain in the ass if you have a lot of tests. So here is the get started page. It's the test that you can find if you look for the WebDriver get started page. It's, I mean, most probably a lot of you are already familiar with this. It just goes on Google, search for cheese, submits the query, and that's it, and then reads the page title. On my machine, it's not a terrible machine, it takes an average of 5 seconds for Firefox. Pretty good with Chrome driver, and don't ask me about Internet Explorer. I hate it, I don't want to touch it. So what we really need to do is to reduce how long it takes for us to get tests, to get the result out of a test. Because, yeah, 3-5 seconds maybe is good enough when you're doing your overnight test. Of course, multiply this by the number of tests you run overnight. But when you are developing and you want to be sure that whatever you're doing, it doesn't break anything, the most correct thing to do is to run every one of your tests, or at least a fair amount of your tests. So 3-5 seconds multiplied by 100, it takes a sensible amount of time. So you want to reduce the coding turnaround. From my point of view, I think you write better code faster and you're actually happier when you can write your code and see have feedback on it immediately. So that's why I started to write Ghost Driver. That is a very cool car. So what's Ghost Driver? It's an implementation of the wire protocol based on PhantomJS. At the moment, it's completely written in JavaScript, and I think it will stick that way. And it's based on a new module that we added to PhantomJS, the web server module, which actually was a very good stress test for the module because I found little bits to fix. But luckily, there is a very good and fast turnaround in terms of pull request and merge inside PhantomJS, so I could do the two things at the same time. One of the reasons for which I wanted to do this, in addition for the fact that we need it in Newstar, there is also the fact that this is the most requested issue, the most requested feature on the tracker for PhantomJS. It's designed to be a remote web driver server, and then we will see why it's a very good point. So, same test again. The only thing I changed is the fact that I'm connecting to the remote web driver. In Ghost Driver, it takes between 1 and 2 seconds, and there it starts to count a lot how fast it is your network. I tried here, and I got all sorts of up and downs with the net on the Wi-Fi. So I'll do the demo, but I don't know exactly what I'll come up with. But the most important thing is I can go with a Ghost Driver down to around half a second to run this test when I'm using it in server mode, meaning I don't have to start and stop PhantomJS every time. I just leave it running and I keep sending tests to it. Seems to be going very fast. When I was coding it, it was actually faster than switching between a code editor and the console for me to get the result. Yeah, let's see if I can do this. So, now I just have the Ghost Driver. And let's see. Yeah. So, yeah, pretty good. It took 1.3 seconds to do the whole thing. Let's see if we want to use Chrome Driver. Chrome Driver is actually very, very fast from my point of view. So, yeah, 2 seconds, 1 second, 3.3. They are very close, but you understand that this kind of difference adds up over time. And if you make the mistake, instead of using Chrome Driver as a server, but you use it in a mode where you start and stop Chrome Driver every single time, then the difference becomes much bigger. It's okay. Readable. So what you see here, this is a very not scientific at all performance measurement. What I did is, with the blue bar, you have the same test executed 5 times, and in green bars, you have the same test executed 100 times. And the different degrees represent the total, is the darker one. The one in the middle is how long it takes to run the test, and the lighter color represents how long it takes to start the driver. When in this configuration, where I start and stop PhantomJS or Firefox driver or Chrome driver at every single iteration, we can say that Ghost Driver and Chrome driver perform pretty similar. Ghost driver, of course, is slightly faster, but they're there. What is really slow is Firefox driver. And most surprisingly, if you can see that, Firefox driver is...
Does it have this thing of a pointer?
Yeah, here and here. Firefox driver actually is the only driver that I could find that it takes more time than to actually execute a test. And that was pretty bad from my point of view. I don't know who wrote Firefox driver. I don't want to offend anyone, so please punch me later. This, instead, is a comparison between Ghost driver and Chrome driver when running both of them in server mode. The difference becomes a little bit more evident between the two. Again, 5 iterations, 100 iterations. Chrome driver is pretty stable. And actually, as expected, this goes is slightly better when you do more iteration because the operating system starts to do all sort of shit with your executable. It doesn't reload it and all this kind of caching. Here, I think it's just my bad programming. I mean, I spend only a week on Ghost Driver, so this can be definitely optimized a bit so that we get better performance with over time and over iterations with Ghost Driver as well. So, at the moment, that's the kind of the pros and cons that I can see are, from the positive side, you get faster result, so your coding turnaround is better. I don't know if it counts for all of you, but from my point of view, at least as a developer, it counts very much how long it takes for me to write something and see the result. It's really important. You can enhance your development environment without having to ask your developers to go through another wiki page in which they need to follow steps and download and configure and anything. You just put everything inside your repository, inside your source code. It's not that big as a binary, and you can have everything wired to everyone, and the only thing they need to do is to download the source code and set up their machine as they would normally do. So it's another burden you try to get rid of. Both PhantomJS and GhostDriver, they're both very hackable and tunable, because either you know JavaScript and then you can help there, or you know C++, you can help on that side. And it's, at least at the moment, it's very fast in server configuration. I say at the moment because, sorry. As you can see, one of the negative points is I spent just a week on this thing, so I only have 13 of the 95 wired protocol commands. I think it's 95. I don't know if any of you can confirm. I did a quick count. So you can't use this in production. It's too early. And yes, PhantomJS is not a real browser, as in it doesn't implement the full Chrome, and there are some behaviors that are not exactly the same. But it is a WebKit engine, so it's what you will expect from a browser. It's not like HTML unit where you really are far from a real browser. What is the status of the project then? As I said, again, I can't stress this enough. And even if I'm stressing it here, you can imagine how many people in a week started to bombard me saying, oh, I cannot use this command or the other command or the other command, because no one read the fact that it was early and just a sort of a drop of a hack that I started. Probably the most important thing for me to say is the fact that I will appreciate help from this community, because you are the guys that know the most Selenium and WebDriver, so we'll probably here is the best hand that I can get to ship this thing. It's going to be in the future part of the new star offering, and yeah, the list of to-do is pretty long, I have to say. At the moment, it's practically not almost doing nothing. There is very little in terms of commands that are being implemented. But probably the most important thing at the end will be to integrate into Selenium, only if they go to Git. No, okay, so no, you're not having this. Thank you. So, do you have any questions?
Hi. You know, in all these graphs you showed before with all the iterations and stuff, did you also check the number of failures and successes in both approaches, just in case there were some flakiness or not?
I get always everyone to execute correctly. So okay. Again, my sample was that simple script, and they always succeeded, both Firefox, Chrome, and Phantom.
No, my question was, and that if this fast tool, you know, you pay a price for that, you know, or not, or is it as reliable as the other drivers in certain situations, or did you find it always similar?
The only case in which I got failures was when I didn't implement the command. I never got situation when Phantom let me down. So at the moment, I'm pretty happy with it. I'm sure this needs to be tested heavily. It's not something that I can say, I do the testing and it's fine. Mm-hmm. But the result so far is really good.
And for you, I mean, what's the key feature that it has that makes it faster than the other drivers? Is it just the fact that it uses just JavaScript, or are there any other?
It's not the fact that it's based on JavaScript. The majority of the performance are out of the fact that you are not drawing anything. The PhantomJS is not drawing. It's WebKit is running up to the point where it's ready to draw, but then we don't. Okay. It's actually saving us a lot in performance. We need to do every other step because you want a completely real behavior of a browser. I have considered actually to write this thing in C++ directly, but it sounded easier to get support from other people if I wrote it in JavaScript instead of C++, because theoretically I could just take PhantomJS, fork it, and do something else.
So in this case, if we don't draw anything, and you were saying before, it's something between HTML unit and Selenium. So what's the benefit we get as opposed to a HTML unit?
HTML unit doesn't really behave like a real browser. There are a lot of scenarios where you can feed it. A practical example, I was working for another company before, and we were using YUI3. HTML unit let us down a lot of times with YUI3. Just because YUI3 was doing so much advanced stuff that HTML unit couldn't cope with it. PhantomJS has been used, is currently in use to them, and I know they are still pretty happy. So.
Question over here.
Who's this guy?
Who is this guy? Yeah. Have you thought about merging GhostDriver into PhantomJS?
Yes, and Aria thought exact opposite. So the main maintainer of PhantomJS thought about the opposite of, for now, track the development on a different repository. But actually, it would make a lot of sense to have everything inside PhantomJS. So PhantomJS can be probably the first browser to have internally and maintain internally its own web driver.
Third,
okay.
Opera were first,
of course,
second.
Opera.
PhantomJS.
Kudos to Opera, absolutely, they made a great job. And who else does it as well?
Chrome.
In my mind, when I think about everything inside, I mean, the actual executable does everything inside. So I will have Chrome with inside the Chrome driver. But yeah, absolutely, they maintain it as well. So yeah, in the long run, I'm sure we are going to have everything in one project. But for the moment, they are two different things.
So one of the things that we find very useful in our tests is that we can take screenshots if they fail, and we can record videos. So before we had headless WebKit driver, right, I played around with that for a little bit and found it incredibly difficult to work out what had gone wrong, because you get a timed out waiting for exception or element not found, and you had absolutely no visibility of what the page looked like whatsoever. Do you have any ideas about how you might solve that, or what you can do to make it possible to debug tests?
Yes. Like this? I think I put it in one of the to-do. Screenshot. The PhantomJS supports natively. It's one of the main features, actually. One of the things for which it's used the most is the fact that to create thumbnails or screenshots of a web page. So we have the feature in. Probably what we can add, and it's completely doable because we have other scenarios and other projects in which we add this kind of stuff, is to actually make the video as well. So, for example, if we want to sample every reflow, we could actually add this feature in PhantomJS pretty easily, because we have full control of the buffer. We are just not drawing that buffer, but the buffer is there. So the moment in which we ask to Qt WebKit, please draw on this buffer, then we can save either the status of the current error page, or your application that is giving you an error, or we could do like create a video with all the screenshots based on every single reflow. That could be very, very interesting, and one of the things that you definitely can implement. Done? Okay, thank you.
All right, we've got a little bit of some time here. The next talk will be Dante Briones. at 2:20, so we have a little bit of time to talk amongst yourselves. Also, on track B is the robot framework. So be back here 10 minutes or so.